Dear students, welcome to EPG Pathshala. I am V.N. Prabhakar from Archaeological Survey of India. In this paper on principles and method of archaeology, today we will be discussing on the public archaeology and salvage archaeology. You might be surprised to know what is public archaeology, what is salvage archaeology, what kind of new kind of terminologies are coming in the archaeological scenario. But we will be having the following objectives to understand how this concept of public archaeology came into being and what is the necessity of salvage archaeology, why we have to salvage the archaeological remains in certain instances. We will understand that, and we will also understand the concept of cultural resource management. What is cultural resource management and how it is related to public archaeology and salvage archaeology? And also related to this field is the kind of legislative measures brought out by certain governments, and also in the case of Indian scenario, Government of India has brought out many legislations for safeguarding the archaeological sites and remains. So we will be looking briefly about that, and also what is the various means to achieve the public archaeology, how we can really make the public aware about the archaeological remains and how it is going to be help them. And also I'll quote certain examples of salvage archaeology which have been successfully implemented in the Indian scenario. First of all, we will try to understand what is the role of archaeology. I mean, how it is really important for understanding our past. It is basically studying the artifacts which have been left over by the past human beings. And initially, these artifacts, they have been collected by the elites only. It's not a subject of the common people. The elites, they were attracted by the works of art of the past. They were collecting them and keeping them as their private collection. Slowly, they were put into some sort of a display and converted into public museums. So we have British Museum is very good example of this regard. And in the Indian scenario, we have the Salarjung Museum, which was initially a private collection, later converted into a public museum. So we have one more instance in the Indian scenario, that is the Chhatrapati Shivaji Maharaj Vastu Sangrahalaya, which was known as the Prince of Wales Museum. It was mainly constructed during the visit of Prince of Wales to the Indian subcontinent. So these were also created only for an elite. It's not mainly related to the public, but initially all these scenario of collecting the artifacts and also archaeology as a discipline, it was largely practiced by the elites and private individuals based upon their interest. And even today, many of the archaeological departments and the scenarios, you'll say professionals are largely involved in undertaking the archaeological pursuits and scholars. But what the archaeology deals with the peoples and the society of the past. I mean, we are studying the past human cultures, how they were coping up with the environment, how they were advancing themselves, but it has direct relevance to the present population. I mean, we are not separated from the past. Whatever we are inheriting, that is from the past only, and our present day culture, it has been completely shaped by our past. So that has to be understood. I mean, making this to be understood by the local population, that makes archaeology relevant, that makes history relevant to them, because many of the local population, they have various kind of lifestyles, customs, traditions. They have been transmitted from the past generation, dating back to thousands of years. So it is relevant mostly to the population, and studying the archaeology will make them better understand, make them respect their culture, so that they, whenever they come across any archaeological remain, they can treat them with a very good respect. So it is relevant to the archaeologist, because it is the role of the archaeologist, because they understand the past culture slightly better when compared to the population. So they have to make the public aware. I mean, what is the nature, what they are performing, why they are performing certain activities, why they are going to excavate, what is exploration, what they will find, what is the meaning behind certain objects. So, and how it is relevant to the present day population. Only the professionals and the archaeologists, they can explain to the public what is the role of archaeology. So why do we also study the past history and archaeology of the bygone ages in the midst of less economic resources? We have less economic resources presently, and yet we need to study the past. So what is the importance? So it is a kind of role of archaeologists to make the public understand how by looking into the past we can learn certain mistakes what we have committed or what kind of technological breakthroughs we have gone through the past to make our lifestyles better in the present, how we need not repeat those mistakes in the future, shaping of the future. So this is more relevant in terms of understanding the past, so that the present day population, they can better appreciate our past for leading their future. So there were different concepts. Initially the public archaeology, the concept was introduced by one scholar named Meg Gimsey. So he was using this phrase exactly not in the context of public archaeology, and he was using this with an objective of defining the necessity of making the public aware of the past without prejudice and biasness. This is the most important aspect. We should not have any prejudice or biasness. Even an archaeologist or a professional working in the field, he should not have any preconceived notion and looking into the past. So he has to retrieve the artifacts as it is coming up and try to interpret in a more objective manner without any kind of preconceived notion. So Meg Gimsey, he while describing the public archaeology, he says like this, there is no such thing as private archaeology. He was relating private archaeology and public archaeology. So initially he started with a phrase known as private archaeology, and the knowledge of the past is essential to our survival, and the right to that knowledge is kind of a human birthright. It follows that no individual may act in a manner such that the public right to knowledge of the past is unduly endangered and destroyed. So this is a quote from Thomas F. King, who also from the concept of the public archaeology defines more further that there is no private archaeology, but it is one of the essential reasons that we have to understand our past to know our survival. Initially, this concept started in the United States of America, where it was directly associated with a concept known as the cultural resources management, which is in short known as the CRM. So it was undertaken in the public interest, and it involved engagement of non-professionals also, not only the professionals but also non-professional also, for investigation of development-led areas. So one has to understand if there is any large-scale developmental project, construction of a highway, construction of agricultural irrigation projects, so that leads to large scale submersion of vast archaeological areas and even landscapes. So this may contain archaeological sites. So initially it was started as a means for investigation of development led areas for understanding the potentiality of archaeological remains coming from this area. So this was also understood as a means to make the developers understand. The developers and the legislators, they are the most important section of the society, because they formulate the acts and rules, they regulate the developmental activities, and the developers, they draw plans of development of a certain area. So they also need to understand the importance of heritage and archaeology, and actually we have to convince them for their protection. It is not that there can be a fight between the developers and the archaeologists, or the legislators and the archaeologists, but we need to convince them why we need to preserve our past, why we need to understand our past. There are a lot of potential of archaeology and heritage, so why we need to really preserve them. So this has to be stressed to them. Many countries have undertaken legislative measures in this regard. In India also we have a legislative setup to safeguard our archaeological past. So in this regard, institutions like the Archaeological Survey of India, State Departments of Archaeology takes various steps through legislations and executive orders, so that we can conserve and preserve our cultural remains. And even today, it has been observed that there is very less public participation over the entire endeavor. But it is not also to be understood that the government alone cannot execute the task, because the remains are very enormous. It is spread over the length and breadth of the country, and only the government alone cannot achieve the target. So it is the public participation, people's participation, we can achieve the preservation and conservation of the past. Also in this regard, in addition to the governments, the universities, the research institutions and various NGOs, they also can undertake this task, and with the help from the government, they can also lead in the task of survey of archaeological remains, and also conserve them and preserve them, and also educate the public. So in this regard, there are a lot of scope of public archaeology. So it has several aspects. It deals with the laws and legislations concerned with the protection, safeguarding of our past. It also related with the tourism related aspects that are directly involved with the cultural tourism, because as you know, in Indian scenario, the tourism is largely dependent on the cultural tourism. People come from far and wide to visit Taj Mahal, maybe Ajanta Caves, maybe Mahabalipuram. So largely they visualize India in terms of cultural rich scenario, or also they come and see some traditional festivals or some traditional religious rituals. So all these things are cultural associations which make our country very popular among even the foreign tourists. So this is also one aspect of the public archaeology, and how the society can really reap from the influx of the tourists to these historical places, how we can also learn from them, and how we can also impart them about the importance of our Indian society and culture. And also it involves the politics involved in the various activities and certain events from our past. So these are all when combined together, it's a scope of the public archaeology. So we have been looking into how the basic understanding of the archaeology, basic understanding of the remains of the past, how the humans, they have to associate them with the past so that they can lead a better life in the future. So these kind of concepts, they were going on through various countries and civilizations, and ultimately the government, it has the power to enact certain legislations. In India, we have a very good history of legislative measures starting from the early 19th century. We have instances of regulations by the local governments, like the Bengal Regulation of 1880 and the Madras Regulation of 1870. They were formulated so that the government can protect the public buildings from misuse. So certain kind of steps have been initiated from the very early past, but these regulations, they were silent on the privately owned buildings which may be of historical or archaeological interest. So next comes a regulation of Endowment Act of 1863, which enabled for the repairs and preservation of religious establishments. Especially the repairs, the provision for repairs were introduced in 1863, and the directive of the government in 1867, it recognized the conservation of monuments that were already located, but also encouraged exploration activities for discovery of more such monuments. So this is one role of how we enlarge our knowledge of archaeological remains and antiquarian remains from a certain region. So it is the necessity for further exploration so that we can know about more and more archaeological remains and make it helpful for preserving our past. There is one more important directive of 1873, which instructed the provincial governments, because at that point of time there was a central government and there was regional provincial government. The central government was instructing the provincial governments that the conservation and preservation of buildings and monuments of historical and archaeological importance, they have been entrusted to the provincial governments. It is the responsibility of the provincial governments, and they have to initiate certain rules and acts and also manage the monuments. So this kind of directives were issued by the government. But the first major act introduced by the then British government is the Treasure Trove Act of 1878. So this is an historical moment when anything buried beneath the surface of historical or archaeological values, so that can be acquired by the government, the means of acquisition, the means of compensation to the public. So the public was highly rewarded by this act. It is not that somebody is snatching away some treasure found in a private property. The private property from where these kind of treasures are found, the owner of the private property, he can be compensated with the metal value. Those are the specific sections in this act which gives provision for compensating the owner of the exact metal value of the market value to the person who discovered it, or from the land from it belongs to. And also an additional extra percentage, so that any discoverer should immediately come to the government and inform the government that we have found such and such treasure, instead of melting them or destroying them. So in 1886 also, in continuation of various measures under the director generalship of James Burgess when he was the director general, the government barred excavation without the prior permission, because anybody can go and excavate and they can destroy and loot whatever coming from the archaeological mound. So the government took a step to ban excavation without the prior permission of the Archaeological Survey of India, and also disposal of the antiquities. Whatever the human past remains, it is coming from this archaeological site, it should not be disposed without the permission of the government. So these kind of legislations were introduced just to help the public also to understand, look, we are these are very much important, it is related to your past only, you should not destroy them, and you should inform the government so that the government also can compensate you in terms of monetary benefits. But even today there is very less awareness of these kind of acts. The Treasure Trove Act is even today it is not widely understood by the public, and whenever they find important coins or antiquities, they immediately melt them and they sell them. So there should be an awareness among the public that if they find some treasure, they should report to the government. So looking into the history of legislations in India that deals with the public as well as the historical monuments and sites, the contribution of Sir John Marshall, who joined as a Director General of Archaeological Survey of India in 1902. So it's very, very important. He was instrumental in promulgating the Ancient Monuments Preservation Act in 1904, which for the very first time introduced aspects of conservation, protection, preservation of monuments and also sites and antiquities. So this is a very important landmark act, which was later enlarged into a much larger act. This act also defined certain terms like ancient monument, antiquity in a very detailed manner. So various comprehensive measures were envisaged to this act, and in the 1958 act we have after the post-independence era, the Ancient Monuments Preservation Act of 1904, it was enlarged much, much bigger, and an act known as Ancient Monuments and Archaeological Sites and Remains Act was promulgated by the Parliament of India in 1858. This act is very comprehensive, and it enabled for the protection of ancient and historical monuments and archaeological sites and remains of national importance. So national importance given to a class of monuments. It is also for the regulation of archaeological excavations in the sites, and for the protection of sculptures whenever they are discovered, carvings and other like objects. So this kind of a comprehensive act was introduced in the Indian Parliament and passed, and it also defined ancient monuments, antiquities, archaeological site and remains and similar things. So in this regard, the exploration activities, it has to be supplemented by some kind of a national register. Unless we have a national register, we may not understand what is the scope of the archaeological wealth and potential we have. And the national register also helps in the developmental activities also. Whenever the register indicates the location of archaeological sites in a particular area, the developers also can use this register to plan in such a manner they can avoid the location of the archaeological sites. So in this endeavor, in 2007, the National Mission for Monuments and Antiquities was set up by the Government of India. The main objective of this mission was to give a national level register, state level register of monuments and antiquities, so that it can be put on the website, made available to all kind of public, so that they can act in a better and responsible manner. However, if we look into the AMSR Act, the Ancient Monuments and Archaeological Sites and Remains Act 1958, it does not specifically mention about the underwater cultural heritage, but we have rules and regulations and acts of other departments which can be at present used for protecting the underwater cultural heritage. And also this act is also silent about the unprotected monuments, even though the kind of divisions have been given, the responsibilities have been given to the union, state regarding the nationally protected monument and the state protected monuments. But in case of any damaged or harm done to an archaeological site or an ancient building which is not in the state or the central list, there is no provision at present, but it can be dealt in a much circuitous manner. The AMSR Act was further amended in 2010. Very recently, it was amended to define a prohibited area that is 100 meters from the protected area and regulated area that is 200 meters beyond the prohibited area. These kind of prohibited and regulated area, they have been created to have a buffer around the monument so that the future development, they may not dwarf the ancient building. Imagine a multi-storied building coming very close to Taj Mahal. What will be the scenario? So we have to ensure very specific things so that these kind of damages are not done to the monuments in the future. So this particular amendment, it was a major attempt to regulate all activities of construction, repairs, renovations near the protected areas due to the remarkable urbanization, because the rapid urbanization, whatever happening in the cities and the developmental activities, they are threatening the areas adjoining the protected monuments and also near to that. So these kind of amendments, even though it affects the public at a large, but for the long term possibility, long term scenario, they are very much essential in understanding the importance of the ancient remains and past and how we should preserve them for the posterity. So the next important promulgation of act is the Antiquities and Art Treasures Act of the Government of India. So it enabled various activities related to the export and trade in antiquities and art treasures. It also helped in preventing the smuggling of antiquities, fraudulent dealings, and also for the compulsory acquisition of antiquities and art treasures, because the private owners, they may misuse them, so that can be also be acquired by the government and display them in public places and to provide for certain other matters connected with further protection. So these kind of measures, they are helpful in understanding the past, also in telling the public about the importance, so that it is not lost forever. If the antiquities are allowed to go out of the country and separated widely from the location where it used to belong to, the public will not understand the importance. But it is also very interesting to see that our acts and rules, it is not directly specifically about the cultural resources management, which we briefly touched slightly earlier. The cultural resource management concept was introduced in the United States of America for the protection of archaeological remains in case of any developmental activities are taking place. But we don't have any specific mention, but it's a general practice among the various departments and various institutions in the country that the potential archaeological potential and an NOC from the Archaeological Survey of India is sought from the developmental department, so that no archaeological wealth is destroyed due to the developmental problem. But there is a necessity for a detailed mention of CRM also, and how it has to be implemented also. So that is one aspect which is currently not dealt in a detailed manner. So we have been seeing about the role of legislations, the importance of the public archaeology, and how the legislations help in protecting the cultural past. But there is a necessity of spreading awareness among the public on how it can be done. There are various means of achieving the concept of public archaeology and making the people to understand the importance of archaeological past. So it is one of the important aspect is the education and making the public aware of our past. So the general awareness among the public is much more crucial, because if they are not aware of their past, they cannot protect them, they cannot they cannot stop anybody coming and destroying the archaeological wealth. So we have to make them aware. So the awareness has to start from a very early age, and it is generally accepted that if you start very early in your life of any understanding concept, it will go a very long way. So the school education, it has to include largely about the importance of the past. The school children may be imbibed with the importance of preservation of our heritage, why we should preserve them, and what is the importance and how they can nurture this cultural heritage so that they can preserve them for the future. So this will help in developing them as a responsible citizen, and they can also go forward and prevent others from destroying our cultural past. So this is a important aspect in which we need to educate the public. The education aspect is much more important, so that we can educate the children at a very young age, so that they can grow as a responsible citizens. And also the role of museums, they have been considered very, very important in the public archaeology, because the museums, they directly connect the public by displaying the important artifacts in its original form. So this is a very important place where the education can be imparted. They encompass a wide variety of subjects. If you go to a museum, you will find all kind of subjects displayed there, from art, history, archaeology, even automobile museums are there, entertainment museums are there. So you have any kind of museums, and they have a very important role, because it display the objects of a particular category for the education and dissemination of knowledge that cannot be deniable. So these kind of places where the objects are displayed, they have a direct impact on the public and to educate them. So in this regard, the museum concept have been introduced much earlier in the Indian scenario. The Archaeological Survey of India introduced the concept of archaeological museums in India, and one of the former director generals of AISI, Hargreaves, he described why we should keep the movable and immovable, movable and small antiquities record from the ancient sites. That has to be kept in close association with the public, because where they belong to, if we remove certain antiquities from a place to a very far away distance, the local public, they may not understand. So it has to be studied in amidst their natural surroundings, from where it is coming from, and not lose focus by being transported. So this is a very important concept, how we need not separate the findings from a particular site to a very far away distance, so that the local people, public and the local population, they also understand and they educate themselves about the richness of the past, and then they can go on protecting the similar resources also. This is so, it's an important concept introduced very, very early in the Indian scenario, and some archaeological museums were also created, and some of the earlier museums are Sarnath, Agra, Ajmer, Delhi Fort, Bijapur, Nalanda and Sanchi. So even today we have a wide range of archaeological museums in the country, starting from the AISI museums, to the state museums, to the central museums, the national museum. So we have a different hierarchy of museums that caters to the different sections of the society. But the archaeological museums of the Archaeological Survey of India, they are located to where these objects belong to. It is not widely separated from the places of origin, but they are located very close to the site from where they were discovered. So from this display of objects and artifacts, we can educate the public in general, and the school children can also be involved in regular programs like the World Museum Day. During the World Museum Day on May 18th, the local population, even the school children, they are invited to visit the museum. They are explained about the importance of the antiquities, and they make themselves aware. So this is the kind of education which is very much important. And in this aspect also, the online resources, which is very much coming into picture nowadays because of the access of internet to a large number of the population, the online resources, it directly reaches to the home. Whatever we are going and visiting a museum to a faraway place or a national museum or a local museum, but now the distant museums can come to our home because of the virtual museum. So in this regard, the National Museum Delhi, it has a very good example of online exhibition on various subjects. So this actually helps the public sitting in the place. They can visit a virtual museum. They can see the kind of importance of the objects and how they can also correlate them with the past. So these kind of resources are very much helpful, and that is available today. So in this aspect, the internet can also play a very, very major role. So even the excavation of archaeological sites, if you might have noticed in the ancient part there are very large scale excavations happening in sites like Harappa or Mohenjo-daro or even in Takshila or even in Haichatra. There are many places where large scale excavations were happening, but nowadays the concept is you excavate very less, you retrieve more and more data, and also engage the local population. Local population, nearby schools and colleges, they can be invited to visit the archaeological sites when the excavation is being carried out. So they can understand in a better manner how we excavate, how we go from the top to bottom, how we kind of retrieve the objects. So they can feel how an ancient house might have looked like, how an ancient kitchen might have looked like, a drawing room or a workplace or a manufacturing place. So how these kind of things can be connected. The school children they visit, like for example, the Archaeological Survey of India, when they conduct the excavation, we invite the school children to come to the site. We educate them, give public lecture there, and also show some of the important artifacts and how it is correlatable with them, how the present society can be benefited by them. We also have small exhibitions with the findings, and that can help in making the local population understand, because we also invite the local administrators and the panchayat people. They also come, they feel pride, I mean, because their village or town is yielding so much of ancient remains. So this kind of even excavation activities can be a very good medium of connecting the public with the past. So this is also a means of education. And finally, we come to an aspect of salvage archaeology, because all these cultural resources management, protection of antiquarian remains, and stopping the movement of antiquities for the benefit of the public, these are all connected with the cultural resources management, which I told you earlier. Cultural resources management, it also similar to the salvage archaeology, because whenever there is a developmental activity is taking place in a area which is to be badly affected by like construction of roads or irrigation projects, construction of dams, so this area should be immediately subjected to archaeological investigation, so that any potentiality can be detected and some of the important things can be retrieved also. So some of the concept like archaeology denies kind of development, it has to be misunderstood. I mean, archaeology, they have to play a medium role, a middle path, so that neither it stops the development, neither it allows the ancient remains to be completely destroyed. So it has to be a middle path, and the concept of salvage archaeology, salvaging important archaeological remains, it happened during the early part of 20th century, actually, by the construction of dams across the river Nile in Egypt. It happened on three occasions, 1905, 1929 and 1960, when the dam was being raised and raised again, the height of the dam. So it used to inundate a large area. So ultimately the Egyptian government, in association with several other agencies, even the UNESCO, they were involved in retrieving certain archaeological remains, and it also involved in the transplantation of the temples at Abu Simbel, because it was to be completely submerged by the Aswan high dam. So it was transplanted to a safer location. So these kind of things started in the Egypt around 1905, and ultimately they were used to safeguard, they were used to investigate the entire stretch of the river Nile where the it is to be submerged, retrieve the artifacts, then transplant some of the important temples, and that's how the archaeological wealth was safeguarded. So this is an example of Egypt, where the salvage archaeology was helped. So in the Indian context also, we have several important developmental projects coming in the post-independence era, and we have examples. There are innumerable small-scale dams and large-scale dams, but here I would like to quote three examples, like the Nagarjuna Sagar Dam on the River Krishna, Srishailam project on the River Krishna, and the Narmada Sagar and Sardar Sarovar project on the River Narmada. So these were very, very large mega projects. The recent one is the Narmada Sagar and the Sardar Sarovar project. But the immediately after the independence, the Nagarjuna Sagar project was conceived, and the first Prime Minister of India, he realizing the importance of the archaeological wealth, he urged the Archaeological Survey of India to do large scale exploration, excavation of the entire valley of this area to retrieve the archaeological remains. And the ASI, it was successful in even excavating sites ranging from prehistoric period to the medieval period. And they also selected the most important ones to be transplanted. So if we go to the Nagarjuna Kunda Hill in the Nagarjuna Sagar area, you will find some of these important monuments and sites. They have been completely transplanted from the original location. They have to be detailed documentation carried out, numbered, each and every member, they are numbered and documented, and they are transplanted, and exactly they are reproduced as it was originally. So it is a momentous and monumental task for the country during that period of the 1950s and 60s, and Archaeological Survey of India successfully transplanted a host of this ancient remains to the Nagarjuna Kunda Hill. So this is a very good example. And also salvage archaeology, it is very much helpful wherever the sites are being destroyed in a large scale manner, because the advent of the canal irrigation in many parts of the country, it has led to destruction of many of the archaeological sites, because now the water is easily accessible for the farmers. They can level the agricultural field or wherever the land is available to them, so that they can reach to the level of the canal, so that the water can reach to their agricultural field. So similar examples we are finding in many parts of the country, like in Karnataka, Tamil Nadu, in Rajasthan, Haryana, where many people, they are completely destroying the archaeological remains. You can see from the photographs how a Harappan site in Rajasthan, it is completely converted into an agricultural fields, and even the people, they are making these kind of arrangements. They are lowering the ground level so that they can put the tractor at the lowest level and put the earth from the both sides, and that's how they remove the archaeological deposit. So in this area, if we do the large scale excavation immediately, at least we can retrieve whatever coming out. Another example in this case of how development leads to discovery of archaeological site is the modern city of Chandigarh. When the Chandigarh city was being planned and constructed during the 1970s, it was again discovered that Harappan burial site and the habitation site was being destroyed. So immediately various agencies, including the Government of India, Government of Haryana and Punjab, they participated and they retrieved a large number of data. So this is the kind of strategy which we need to approach, adapt. So whenever there is a kind of developmental project, it may not be completely stopped, because it the public also needs that, but the archaeological wealth cannot be compromised. If it is of utmost importance, they can be investigated and they can be retrieved, or if necessary, they can be transplanted to a safer location, or if necessary, if it is of utmost national and international importance, the developmental project can be slightly moved away from the planned site. So this can be happen in the case of salvage archaeology, which is also a means of public archaeology, as we have seen so far. So these examples, they clearly make us understand what is public archaeology and what is salvage archaeology, what is the necessity to preserve them. And to conclude, so far we have seen what is public archaeology, how it was started, how the concept of cultural resources management it started, what is the necessity to retrieve the archaeological remains found from a site, and how by means of education and making awareness, the public can be understood about the richness and the importance and the necessity to preserve for the future of archaeological remains can be understood. And in this regard, museums really play a very good and important role, where it can be centers of education, because the objects are there, the original materials are there, so we can really correlate the objects with to the public and make them to understand in a better manner. The salvage archaeology, lastly, it is very much equivalent to the cultural resource management of the USA, and it is an attempt, very good attempt, to retrieve and safeguard the archaeological remains from those areas where the developmental projects threaten them. So you can also refer to other quadrants of this module to understand more. There is a reference list. You can also read additional resources. Thank you.